Hello everyone, my name is Ducky Aisha, and that's my Twitter name. My Tumblr name is Clodius Polcare, if you want to follow me there. And I am going to play some Minecraft, and I wonder if you guys want to hang out with me while I do that. I kind of play Minecraft differently. I don't really think of it as a video game. It's kind of an opportunity to time. So I play on peaceful mode, and it's dawn here, and I'm looking at the first street of my Etruscan necropolis that I'm trying to recreate in Minecraft. I wanted to do peaceful mode on survival because I kind of wanted to make a more realistic way of doing it. Instead of in creative mode where you can just have all the resources you want, I kind of like that you have to find the resources and you have to augment things as you find more things, which I think is more true to how the Etruscans might have done it. But the Etruscans didn't have to deal with zombies and skeletons, so, you know, neither do I. And I kind of like the simplicity of it as well, so you'll notice I don't have a big redstone factory or anything like that. I'm just doing things the 4th century BC type of way, although I do have some TNT, so I might cheat a little bit. But, overall, I'm just trying to do this in a very calming, sort of archaic, antique way as much as you can in Minecraft. You'll notice the beautiful vista that I have. Look at that sand, the desert, and my beautiful tombs. If you don't know what an Etruscan necropolis is, basically it's a city of tombs, and there have been Etruscan necropoli found all throughout Italy. My favorite is the one at Orvieto, which is the one that I got to see in person. And it was so beautiful and striking, and I was just so overcome by it. I love the Etruscans. Sadly, I did my final project in my archaeology class on Etruscan art and Etruscan pottery, and how Etruscans interacted with Greek cultural influences. And I find it really fascinating how the Etruscans really were multicultural. They weren't isolated. The world was not as small as we think it was in antiquity. And I really like Etruscan art because it is so lifelike. I do like Greek pottery and the way that Greek artists paint, but there's something about Etruscan red figure pottery. Oh, there's this beautiful pot of Alcestis and Admetus that I love. There's this pot of Troilus and Achilles, which, you know, is one of the Etruscans' favorite mythological motifs, and I just think it's so beautiful, and so lifelike. The exact materials they had at their disposal were not exactly the same as what the Athenians had, so instead of doing the firing treatment, where they fire the clay and they apply the slit very carefully and use incisions to create lines, they use very fine paint to create lines, and I think it's really lifelike and beautiful when they do that. And I'm just so awed by Etruscan art, and Etruscan necropoli often have beautiful art. The tomb paintings in places like Tarquinia, you know, speak to that. And I just love the Etruscans, and I love Etruscan language and Etruscan history and Etruscan culture and Etruscan art. And I want to recreate an Etruscan necropolis in Minecraft, and maybe you guys will have fun while I do that. I'm going to show you the tombs I have once I finish clearing out this area of a tomb, or for a new tomb. I tried to give similar grave goods as you would have found in an Etruscan tomb, if you were really excavating one. Like I said, I worked on the Etruscans for my archaeology class, and I haven't done any actual digging because I'm not really an archaeologist, I'm a scientist, but I've read a lot, and that counts for something. One thing that is a little bit upsetting about Minecraft is that I can't really recreate the beauty of Etruscan pottery, but or the beauty of Etruscan murals and Etruscan tomb art, But Etruscan grave goods, I can at the very least get what they might have been in terms of objects. I think I'm gonna leave this tree there, kind of overlooking the tomb, unless it gets in the way. I really like it. I don't know if they would have cleared it out, but I kind of like that it gives a sort of, abandoned feel to it, as if nature has taken it over. But at the same time, the place that I've created is already kind of active, so maybe I shouldn't do that. Well, we'll see if it gets in the way of my tomb. So this is 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Two more. Okay. So this is where the next tomb is going to be. And then I think I'm going to start going in a different direction, like another line somewhere else, or turn the way the next tomb is oriented, because I looked at a plan of an Etruscan tomb, Etruscan necropolis at Orvieto, when the tombs are not in exact lines, and they often aren't. There's like paths and streets and stuff, and it's not just a straight line, but I want to make this one line first and make it like a street of tombs. And I haven't decided if I should pave the area outside the tombs, if I should leave it dirt, or if I should leave it grass. We'll have to see when we get there. And at this point, I'm just trying to do it one tomb at a time. And see where that road takes me. Oh, look at this beautiful lake. I don't know if I should block that up or if I should move it. It's so beautiful. I don't want to waste it. Yeah, oh, look at this one. Okay, so each of my tombs is built in a very similar way, because when I was in the Etruscan necropolis, I noticed a sort of similarity. Not identical, but similar. So you can notice that some of the tombs are taller than the others, and some have more squares on top of the carved sandstone blocks. So what I have is I use smooth sandstone for the walls, and there is this overhang actually when you go inside. And the carved sandstone is the name, or representative of the name of the owner of the tomb, or the head of the family that would have had would have owned the tomb. And the name is usually carved on here, and it's so cool. I don't really know how to do this, but if I could, I would juxtapose the image of the name of the tomb, like a picture of it, right here. I can't, because I don't know how. I really am kind of 2,500 years old. I don't really know how to use technology. This is just live stream Procaster from like 2008. So, yeah. Oh, yeah. So here's a picture, example of a tomb. Here's my polished diorite steps that I have, polished andesite floor, some biers, and these pots that represent the Athenian pottery that Etruscan nobility would have imported. Or if we're thinking after the middle of the 4th century BC, Etruscan produced pottery begins to not only increase in amount, but in quality. So some of the most beautiful Etruscan pots are from the middle of the 4th century BC and later. But they did import Athenian pottery excessively throughout the Archaic and early Etruscan cities age. And I have some banners. I don't know if they would have had those, but I like the thought of it. And I have, oh, one thing I thought was really cool is I have these armor stands with the armor on them, and it's really cool. It's kind of like, they would find Etruscan armor in here, and I thought I could use this gold armor to represent a very high status individual. Also, this man has, or woman, actually, Etruscan noblewoman had high status in their society as well, so it could be a woman, but there's a sword and an iron helmet and some bones to represent the actual occupant of the tomb. I'm thinking of putting some string in there as well, maybe to represent thread or weaving. But maybe this was a man's tomb, I don't know. Maybe it's a man and a woman's tomb, because oftentimes Etruscan couples had the same tomb. The family had one tomb, and the couple would have a sarcophagus with them laying together on it. It's very wholesome. This one doesn't have the armor, so maybe he was less rich. Oh, but he has some emeralds and bones, and he has some hearts, so he's fine. Or she's fine. Etruscans, we need to think about the relative gender equity in our society. So, yeah. This one, I gave horse armor too, because I actually saw horse armor from Etruscan times, which I thought was super cool. I put some flowers there for them. And, oh, there's another one that I put another piece of armor. He has a lot of things, but I'm going to take this iron ore out so I can smelt it. And he has a lot of bones, so maybe this could be a whole family's tomb. To go over to my furnace, I was making some terracotta glazed because I thought the glazed terracotta designs in Minecraft are so beautiful, and I could use it to represent maybe painting, and I could use it to represent maybe the frescoes that you get in tombs like the ones in Cerveteri or Tarquinia. Especially the ones in Tarquinia. I love them so much. They're so beautiful. I know I've said that before. But I really do love them. Make some another better shovel to dig with. Okay. Yeah. So this is just going to be me talking and working on my Etruscan tombs. It's not very exciting, but maybe we'll all have a good time. I have nothing better to do. So, let's do it. Yeah, I'm sick right now. I'm trying to get better before I go to grad school. So, hopefully that works out. I have surgery soon. In the meantime, I'm just chilling. And I've been working on some things. I've been sewing. I'm actually sewing an Etruscan mirror embroidery. Like, an embroidery based on the pattern of an Etruscan mirror. It's a beautiful mirror that I really liked. I didn't see it in real life, unfortunately. But some of the designs are very difficult, very complex, very detailed. This one is slightly simpler, which is good because my embroidery has some limits in terms of skill level because I'm not, you know, an expert at it. I'm just having fun, just having a good time. And I didn't want to put myself... Okay, this is going to get in the way, maybe. I think it's right in where my door is on. Okay, I'll keep it for now. I really want to see if I can make the tomb around it. Oh, but it's getting dark. And I don't want to not be able to see, so let's go to sleep. Yeah, so I've been doing that, and I've been doing some Latin. I don't know Greek, unfortunately, so I don't know if I could have had a conversation with a noble Etruscan who would have known Greek and not really the sort of Latin we know. You know, Cicero even talks about how Latin from a few hundred years ago is very difficult for him to read. So I would have had no chance reading whatever sort of Latin existed in the in whatever Rome was at the height of Etruscan power. Etruscans obviously didn't speak Latin, they spoke Etruscan. And we don't know much about Etruscan. We know some things. We know what we found in tombs, which is pretty goth, that's about it. But yeah. I was doing some Latin, reading some Ovid. I really like Ovid. He's so fun. He brings me so much joy. He's so funny. He's so charming. I love him. But I was actually doing a more somber Ovid. I was doing his Herodes, which I really like. I did one about Orestes and Hermione, and I think it's really sweet. Because I love Orestes, and I know he did one about Dido and Aeneas, which is, you know, the most famous one, probably. Although the Helen and Paris one is really funny, also, because Paris is like, first of all, I'm not from a cursed house, so point. And, I mean, how can Menelaus even come back from that? Because it's true, like, Paris is not from a cursed house, and he didn't have a nightmare house childhood. But Helen doesn't really care about him, so it's really funny, the response that Ovid gives. And, you know, I was joking with my friend about how this Roman man from the 1st century AD kind of had a better Helen than many adaptations that I've seen. And it's because he actually read the Iliad is the thing. He actually read the whole Iliad, so that's good. He had to. But... Yeah, it's like that if you read the actual Iliad. You would understand, just like Ovid, who is a true intellectual. Even though he's kind of a freak, I still love him. We read only one or two poems of Ovid in the Latin elegy class that I took in the spring, which was kind of sad. We spent a lot of time on Propertius, which I'm not going to complain about because I love Propertius. But, you know, I feel like Ovid was cheated, and he might be upset about that. Only to get some polished diorite. So in the tombs that I saw, they didn't really have a differentiation in the steps, in terms of what stone was used, but I really wanted to use a different stone for the steps to make it look fancier, I guess. And we'll see if that works out. I really like the uniformity that I've created, but with slight variation, I feel like it's authentic, and I hope that you guys like it. But it's really not for you, not to be mean. It's for me and my things that I'm doing. So, I need to see if I can put this name tag somewhere. I really like the idea of having actual Etruscan names here. I have to look them up before I get back to y'all about it, but I want to give the impression that there are really Etruscans here, with their actual names. And I like how I use the carved sandstone to represent Etruscan names, but it's not really the same. Let me dig in my diary. Anyway, so yeah, I've been doing that, been sewing, been reading, doing all of it. And you know, I was talking, or I was on my girlfriend's blog, and she reblogged, or she made a really good translation of a line from Seneca's Medea, and oh, it kicked so much ass. And I remembered how much I love Seneca and tragedy, and so I'm really tempted to translate Thyestes, because I already translated Seneca's Agamemnon, and if you want, I can give you the link to that. But you know, John Darnielle, lead singer of the Mountain Goats, he translated Seneca's Thyestes when he was a senior in college, and you know, I love Emily Wilson's translation of Seneca's Thyestes. I think it's great and fun, and I think it's what Seneca would want. But on the other hand, I kind of want to give it a try because, you know, John Darnielle is a person who means a lot to me, and I love the Mountain Goats, and I love Seneca. Oh, iron. And I'm no Emily Wilson, obviously, but I just want to see what I can do, and maybe I'll have fun with it like I had fun with the Agamemnon. And you know, translating the Agamemnon really gave me a greater appreciation for Seneca's take on that particular tragedy, because you know, bringing it back to the Etruscans, I feel like Seneca has a really Etruscan take on it. He focuses on Agamemnon and Clytemnestra's relationship, which is really interesting because I feel like a lot of people don't think about what they had before the tragedy struck. But Seneca does, and the Etruscans do. And that was the subject of a paper that I presented at a conference this spring, was the Etruscan take on the House of Atreus, and in particular the Orostia, because the Etruscans really love it. I got to see this in Italy, but it's a beautiful Akrotirion of Orestes. And oh, the Etruscans they just love it. They love the House of Atreus, and I relate to that. That's relatable. But this Akrotirion of Orestes actually predates Aeschylus by 30 to 50 years, so it's not like, you know, they got swept up in the aftermath of that game-changing tragedy. Oh, I already have the andesite. They already had a tradition established. And it's a different tradition because the Greek artists generally don't depict the matricide scene, but the Etruscans excessively do. There are multiple mirrors where Orestes is killing his mother, and it's really interesting to think about that, and in the context of what the Etruscan family was like, the power that women had relatively, the role of women in the family, especially the aristocratic family, for whom we have the most evidence, obviously. And I might get more into that in later episodes, but for now, I'm just gonna leave it at that and keep talking about, you know, Seneca. But yeah, so Seneca's Agamemnon has that interesting take, has that interesting aspect. And, you know, I think Seneca is excellent at creating psychologically complex and very real characters. I feel like his Clytemnestra is very realistic because she's not cruel and evil. She's hurting, and she's driven by pain and fear. And she didn't really let herself heal from the Iphigenia debacle, and she's just kind of nursing this wound. And it brings her nothing but pain, and it's a very realistic response to tragedy, and it just creates more tragedy. And I really like Seneca's take on it. Oh, if I could just tell him. Obviously I can't, but I don't know if that was intentional, but it's really, really good. And his Aegisthus as well is very complex, especially more so than the Greek authors ever give him. It's so good. I love Seneca. You know, and I wonder if there's something in there in the fact that his Agamemnon has this sort of focus on Agamemnon and Clytemnestra as a sort of as a thing that was as a functional relationship that existed before. You know, Euripides teases us with it a little bit in Iphigenia and Aulis, but he kind of destroys it because he has that bullshit about Agamemnon being Clytemnestra's second husband, which I don't buy, so whatever. That makes no fucking sense, Euripides. But, you know, Seneca tells us that Clytemnestra still loves him somehow. And there's a part of her that remembers what they had before. And that's deeply tragic, the fact that she still loves something about him. And she can't let go of what they once were. And he kind of emphasizes, I think, the destruction and the loss of this familial bond. And the bond of marriage collapsing because, you know, he betrayed her trust, and that's the crux of it. And that's what the Etruscans, I think, saw as well. You know, they very much placed a great import on marriage relationships. You can see in Etruscan tombs a sort of parity between husband and wife, where they're on the sarcophagus together. Their relationship is centralized. Oftentimes, actually, in depictions of mythological figures, Etruscans focus on the family bonds. Oh my gosh, and Alcestis and Admetus is a great example because they love to draw them in that final embrace, which is awesome. The way it's drawn is beautiful. You can look it up. There's this one beautiful vase. Oh, it's so good. Anyway, so, I don't know, I like the parallels there, and I wonder if translating Thyestes, I'll get the same sort of appreciation for that play, and for thinking about the psychology of those characters as well. They're not really as complex as Aegisthus and Clytemnestra, because they're more, you know, Atreus is practically a video game villain in that play, but I still think it would be fun. Oh, well, am I not playing any music? I'm sorry, guys. Yeah, I like playing on peaceful mode, but I totally forgot. Usually I like listen to music or I watch Netflix while I play Minecraft. And so I don't put music on. But I totally forgot that because there's no sound. You guys won't hear anything. That's really bad of me. I won't do it next time. Yeah, and I was going to do some more fun of it, maybe to offset, you know, Seneca's tragedy in the sort of way that works. I really like Amores. If you have a favorite Ovid poem, please tell me, and I'll try and do a fun translation for you. I love Ovid. He's great. He's so fun. He's so witty. I thought I was going to hate him, actually, when I read him, because I'm like, oh, he's so smug. He hates Elegy. Well, not he loves Elegy, but he makes fun of it. And, you know, I sincerely like Elegy. So I thought he was, like, going to make fun of me. But he won me over with his charm. Ugh. He's so good. I love you. I love Ovid. It's kind of weird, but whatever. So yeah, if you have a fun Ovid poem that's kind of short, maybe send it to me and I'll do a translation if you really want it. I use so much sandstone when I'm making these tunes. I really do kind of want to see if I can do something with terracotta. I don't know what though. Maybe I can do a design on the floor. Oh, I was trying to make a Roman villa in a previous world, but it was really hard for me to think about how the roof would work. I'm not an engineer or anything. And obviously, if I make an Etruscan tomb, it can just be a flat roof like that. I don't have to think about that, so it's kind of a cop-out. But also, it would have been a very desolate villa because I don't have the furniture with which to furnish it. How long has it been? Oh my gosh. Almost 26 minutes. Wow. Let me... let me stop then. And we started on a tomb today, and I hope you had fun. And we'll keep working on this tomb later. And maybe you'll learn more about Etruscans or whatever else you want. So, yeah. See you.